The initial crime that Robbins committed was to murder his commanding officer in cold blood.
The international prison system has given up all hopes of your rehabilitation.
We meet up with Robbins as he's being transported to a maximum security penitentiary in a very barren desert location.
There's no chance of reprieve here, no possibility of escape. You are condemned.
Leviticus is simply the highest security prison. It's a multinational private organization. The warden is judge, jury, and executioner.
I run a multinational business here, Mr. Robbins. Basically, I take human garbage from around the world and reprocess it. I'm very good at this business because I make all the rules. Was there anything you wanted to add?
To never turn your back on me again.
The final solution is invoked. The warden has him transported to a secret penal island colony and left there to survive or die.
In a sense, they're banished to nothingness forever.
You know, in America, they always say, forget these prisoners, man. Forget rehabilitation. Put them on an island. You always hear that. Well, here we are.
Prisoner 2675 has been delivered, sir.
Robbins arrives on this island and is immediately captured by the wild people of this place.
All of the convicts that have dropped on the island over the past 10, 15 years form two societies, the largest of which are the outsiders. Basically, they're anarchists. It's rule by the sword, survival of the fittest, so on and so forth.
Stop!
...200 deluxe rooms, heated outdoor pool, and a staff of caring professionals. Welcome to vacation paradise. I hope you take plastic.
The Outsiders Camp was something out of a Joseph Conrad novel, if Joseph Conrad had been writing in the latter part of the 20th century.
It's actually got an incredible atmosphere, you know, because you walk through the sort of jungle and suddenly there's this massive, crumbling, decaying sort of Holiday Inn in the middle of the jungle and full of the most horrendous people you've ever seen, all taking up residence there.
We had basically five different gangs in Marek's village. We had Marek's gang, who was supposed to be, you know, the biker type, sort of motorhead type, toughest ones that would be tattooed and longer hair. And then we decided there'd be the skinheads, who were usually like the opposing gang to that, and who would also be tattooed and filthy and that.
And then you have people who have perhaps been on the island the longest and have reverted to very, very primitive ways, the tree people, the mole people, the primitives.
And then we felt we just wanted a bit of colour, so we added what we called the techno warriors, or a slightly feminine bunch, really. We got the idea from nomads in Nigeria, how they decorate themselves up to dance a woman when they go to find their brides and things like that. It's a good opportunity to do some very different things.
I've taken the liberty of scheduling a variety of stimulating activities for your enjoyment. Shuffleboard, water sports. Now, because some of the activities here can be extremely rigorous, we're very selective about our clientele. We like to make absolutely certain they meet the requisite physical demands. So, just to get that old heart pounding a little faster, we thought, 5 minutes in the pool with Ralph, our director of aquatic activity.
I think he's probably starved for good company. I think Merrick's actually quite bright. And if you look round at the gang, I'm not sure there's a lot of people he could have an after-dinner conversation with. Whereas Robbins probably, you know, he could go and have a drink with.
It's not exactly what we had in mind, but extraordinary.
I could use a man like you. Deluxe rooms, run of the grounds, free meals. Anyone you can catch, kill and eat.
What if I say no?
That would be very disappointing.
Now, being a strong individual, Robbins eventually escapes from there.
Oh.
Well, in the story, our hero has been pinned against a cliff by the bad guy, Stuart Wilson, who plays Merrick. He gets poison darts shot in him. He starts to pass out, turns and falls some 300 feet, as you see, below to the water. Because of the nature of the area that we're working in, we called in Ken Bates from America, who brought in two special descender rigs so we could both drop the stuntman, Mitch Dean, as well as the camera operator behind him. So we're trying to create a little different look on the high fall. The camera follows him for a couple of hundred feet, and then after about 200 feet, the camera starts to slow down and pans down, and when you think the guy's about to hit the water, you look down, there's still another 100 feet of descent to go before he hits the water below. So we're just trying to find a unique way of shooting an old gag.
Bye.
And on to the rest of the film.
He is taken into the insider community, finally. The insiders are run by a man called the Father.
What is this place?
Sanctuary, Mr. Robbins.
The Father is played incredibly insightfully by Lance Henriksen, with whom I worked on the first Terminator and in Aliens.
Another year has passed. The first for some. For others, just one more. We have proved to ourselves that we cannot be written off. That our lives mean something. We are not animals. We're human beings. That's our reprieve. That's our pardon. That's our freedom.
You have to believe that this man, who is not a giant in stature, could bring all of these convicts together in search of redemption.
I mean, I kept finding truths that were personal. And I knew that was the only way I could do the role. We did a funeral scene, and we were talking about these men died, you know, risking their lives for us. They gave up their lives for us. And the lines that I found myself saying at the end were, and when you reach for the fruits of their labor, and you find
that gone, that's when we'll miss them.
Everybody within that society works for the community, works for each other.
I heard you escaped from Marek. No one's ever done that before. I just wanted to meet the badass son of a...
Don't.
Sure. Sorry.
I play Casey. He's kind of the young, innocent, sympathetic character in here. And he's probably the one guy on this island who doesn't belong. He shouldn't be here.
Supply drop!
What?
Supply drop! It's for the outsiders. We don't get any.
How often do they come?
Twice a month, maybe? Hey, if you're thinking about trying to jump that chopper, forget it. They pick a new spot each time. We never know where. Even if we did, who's gonna fly it? Most of these cons can't even read.
I can't.
What, fly a chopper?
No, read.
Casey can see that Robbins wants to get off this island really badly, and that's something Casey also wants to do. And he's a follower, and Robbins is a leader. And that's, you know, that's the way it works with those kind of people.
You're on an island, Mr. Robbins. They call it Absolom, situated approximately 200 miles off the mainland.
Dysart is our mad inventor, played with comic turn, I think, by Jack Shepherd.
He's got the technical and the scientific know-how, which enables him to make virtually anything out of whatever materials are available. Dysart has made a boat in secret, which will take a small number of people off the island.
How much further, Mr. Dysart?
500 meters.
It's gonna make it. What the hell is that?
Get me a chopper.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Missile. Boom!
Everybody, help! Come on, come on, come on! possible the cooling mechanism failed. Triggered the infrared.
It's bullshit and you know it.
Ernie Hudson plays Hawkins.
I'm the head of security, and at first I thought it being very military, this guy was very straight-laced and he dressed a certain way. Now I don't seem that way at all. I think he does feel that this is his family.
Oh! What are you doing? No one goes out at night. We're all cons here. We're all lifers. And just like in the joint, we got rules. You could have been an outsider. If you're lucky, I didn't kill you.
Wait!
I think of Stefano, played by Kevin J. O'Connor, as an agent, a Hollywood agent.
Mr. Robbins, this is Stefano. Anything you need, he's your man. He's got it.
Okay, I like the boots. Here's the deal. You sign them to me for what I call merchandise on hand. You keep the boots, but when you die, they're mine, okay?
He does that with everyone.
He's in charge of the workers that are in the water, in the ocean, and collect things that have made it through the ocean water.
In the village, where every little piece of scrap is important to the technology of the community, a character like Stefano is absolutely vital.
Hey, Mr. Killian, how about two shots of your finest 12-day-old?
Piss off!
Killian provides the merriment and the drinks, and he's looked up to, I suppose, like anybody who's a keeper of the spirits would be.
Down the hatch. Brain spasm. That's taking me years to get that effect.
He also can adapt it to make high octane and use it as an explosive. In effect, I think there's probably very little difference between the stuff they drink and the stuff they use to blow up people, you know.
And then there's King, who has a caring spirit.
I host the newcomers. Right, you'll find everything you need in a drawer over there.
Now, I suggest a comprehensive oral hygiene program. Trench mouth is rampant, and do wash your face thoroughly before you shave. A staph infection could kill.
I mean, he's got a fetish. I mean, a serious one about health and about being clean and about being no dust or anything like that. In fact, in the piece, he's got together this feather duster, which he cleans his house with, made up of these rather attractive feathers. And as you turn it, and he blows the dust away at the same time, see how clean you can get with this little item.
I designed King's hut in this position so that when Robbins wakes up after his sort of nightmarish escape from Marek's camp, he wakes up and he walks towards the doors, and he pushes the doors open, and the first thing he sees is the inside of his village laid out before him like that, sort of a totally new world.
I think this set is really like the star of the movie. It's a character that's so beautifully wrought. It's amazing. Because all you'd have to do is run a bunch of actors in here and leave them alone for a couple of days, and they would create their world.
You can see all the 8-year-olds, oh, I wish I could live there. Oh, God, you know, have all this fun.
We're actually standing now on one of the guard towers on the perimeter fence that surrounds the whole village. And I actually designed it around a sort of Mott and Bailey castle, which was in the Norman conquests of England, which was a sort of central keep, which is the farthest tower that you see behind us in the middle of the lake. And that's the keep where they all retreat to when they're under attack. And the rest of the village, where they actually live, work, and as say, their agriculture and minor industries like pottery and weaving, is in all the other huts that we see around us.
I love the principles by which both designers have worked. They haven't cheated. Alan Cameron constructed a set, and Norman Morisot has constructed costumes, which are absolutely pure in the way that they've been conceived. Everything is made from materials which are available in a small forested island, and the kind of things that might possibly have been washed up on the beach.
People are definitely going to see some wild and outrageous wardrobe and costumes. I've never seen anything like it.
Everything that our characters wear was made by hand and could conceivably have been found or woven or in some way created with the bounty of the island, or what was left there by the civilization that left it behind.
And this is entrance to Dysart's hut. He's got a water wheel here, which is actually practical. When we're filming, it goes round. The water actually comes from the tower behind us and powers it, which powers some of the machinery inside the hut. And this is his hut, as I say, it's all found on the beach, and he uses everything to make things around the village. One of the things that he made was this water clock, which again, on film works. The water actually drips from the water wheel, and we've got the hours, the minutes and the seconds, and it's miniature water wheels that catches the water and actually turns, and they're linked through with camshafts and gear drives, so it actually does work. We actually put a notice up into the shops in Atherton to get pottery people, weavers, blacksmiths to work here, and had a fantastic response to it. Now, it's a really good area. There are people who can almost do anything in that sort of arts and crafts line. And a lot of the carpenters who actually built the set, then when the set was finished, actually became extras.
This set would not have been built in America, not to this degree, not to the detail. I mean, it's unbelievable. Everything here is functional. Everything here works, all the buildings. This could be, I mean, people could live here. I personally wouldn't want to live here, but I can see that, I mean, conceivably.
It would be nice to, you know, have a swimming pool. I think that would be my ideal addition to the site, beautifully clean swimming pool.
I'd put in heating and air conditioning myself.
Probably a dentist, because I have the worst teeth on the island.
Women.
Women. There's no women here.
It's very brave of them. There's not one female character in the script, and it's very brave not to resist the temptation to say, we've got to find a way to write a woman in somewhere.
So maybe you've been in prison long enough, maybe you've sort of gotten past that sort of thing. I don't know.
And an airline stewardess. Not for any sexual reasons, just someone to pass up peanuts and be nice.
If anything, I mean, Australia here is just, I mean, as you could see, it's so beautiful that why would these guys, I mean, our question was, gosh, it's so pretty here, why would they want to get off the island?
The fabulous locations we have in the film are wonderful on screen, but they were a nightmare to achieve.
We all walk in the mud and get our shoes sucked off by the mud. We've had 6 days of sunshine and 90 days of rain here. With pythons so big across the road that they'll swallow your pit bull. I mean, it's unreal.
Get me out of here!
Help! I was admired for this tremendously. The Australian crew have been terrific. And it's not simply saying that because this is obviously Australians are going to see it. I mean, they genuinely are. And they have worked damned hard.
It rained a lot, and as you know, there was tons of mud. But it just didn't bother me, and I was too busy and too focused on what I had to do to be worried about that. And if anything, it just added an extra edge to the movie, I think.
Ray Liotta is an actor I've followed since I first saw him on screen in Something Wild. And I thought that he lit up the screen. I think we were very lucky to tempt him with the lead role in an action-adventure film, something that he hadn't tackled before.
Some of the other parts that I've done have been a little darker, and I wanted to do something that was a little more heroic. It was fun to do something. I've always wanted to do an action movie, like I'd like to do a mystery or a thriller.
Connie's saying is if you throw the punch,
okay,
and you block, you stay right up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I myself personally like to embrace every situation that I'm put into and, you know, try to make it as real as possible.
Do once more. Rats on. And hold them as many on the shoulders as possible.
Well, actually, they were a lot sweeter and nicer than I mean, they were lab rats, so it wasn't that bad. But when you have about 100 of them on you,
got it?
Ew.
You have proven yourself a highly resourceful man. We'd like you to join us.
All I want to do is get off this island.
I think the interesting thing about the character of Robbins in the film is that he is not simply a cookie-cutter good guy. He's done a villainous thing.
Psychological baggage. There's something that happened in his past that's obviously scarred him for life. Has caused him to shut down.
You were a soldier. You must have fought for something once.
He is running away from the very thing that we've established here. He wants to get away from
rules. He doesn't feel like he needs a community. He doesn't feel like he needs anybody.
What's going on?
The man fell asleep at his post.
He was warned.
A guard is found sleeping for the second time, and the father, in all his pompousness, banishes the guy out away from the insider's refuge, and this guy, pretty much, once you leave those walls, you're as good as dead.
Any man who, by action or omission, jeopardizes the lives of any or all among us commits a capital offense. The penalty is banishment.
In order to protect what little we have left in this world, there's a responsibility. Not just in terms of making sure that he's not there, but in terms of the potential that all of us are capable of falling asleep, that we're all capable of reverting back to the ways that got us here in the first place. And so the last thing you can afford is being tolerant.
Well, redemption, I think, is the overall theme of the movie. Can man be redeemed? It addresses the split inside of all of us as human beings.
Well, I mean, you dump a whole lot of bad people on an island, and they have a choice to make. They can either sort of dissolve into complete anarchy, or you can try and reform a civilized society. And so it's a straightforward sort of moral tale, and the good guys win, basically. Well, they were.
I've been under a lot of stress lately. The reason for this is very simple. I really want to be in charge.
He's going to sort of arrive with 600 men and just run over the place. And when he arrives, it's going to be the last great sort of push.
I mean, it is an action film, and we had a lot of, I don't know how many hundreds, a lot of extras. I mean, the fight scenes are, enormous.
You can do that, right? And come in and do this. Come in and sweep him underneath, you know? Flip his feet up in the air like that, right?
Our largest battle scene has 400 people in it, but there's quite a variety of weapons. Some of the outsiders' weapons are things like old shovels that they've cut up, and we have these in steel, and we also have plastic ones, which we use for the fight sequences. And the primitives have clubs and blowguns, spears, bows, weapons like that. Because the insiders are meant to have had the technology to cast weapons. We've cast up swords out of aluminium, pike and lance-type weapons, axes. This is one of the crossbows which is operative, which we keep locked at all times, other than when we're supervising the firing on set.
Stand them down and work on getting them up as quickly as you can, right?
Well, first of all, most of my films in the past, while they've been technologically very complicated, haven't been populated by quite as many people as we have in this picture.
So, guys, just keep going straight through down to the marquee, please.
We got four more. Come on, guys. Can you change quickly and move that? Oh, God. Can you go without a shirt? The tents are fantastic, please.
You need to go around the corner and get armor on as soon as you're dressed.
This is the new look.
Next!
Oh, look, he looks like a really rough one. Smooth as baby's body.
Anyone who hasn't been through makeup yet, come on over.
Never noticed.
How many people have you met up this morning?
I've lost count, but heaps. We have about 250 extras coming in today and then about 400 tomorrow. So it's like a factory at the moment. I've lost count.
Let me hit!
I think they're the most exciting bunch of extras I've ever seen in a movie. We really had some strange ones, though.
The extras that we had were enthusiastic, gung-ho, and for the most part felt they were contributing to the picture as actors.
You're watching Ray down here.
And when Ray Liotta, to get his energy level up, would scream out, the extras would scream back.
Ha! Yeah! When the climax of the film proved to me you can do it. Here we go. And 3, 2, 1, action!
It was pretty mammoth, you know. That many guys screaming and running at you, it gives you a good scare.
Now pull it up and try and aim the top of where you imagine the fort might be out there. There you go. You ready? And he tells you, fire. Good. Next man.
I think it's an adventure story set in the future, and yet we take you back in time. They have to basically fight for their lives hand to hand. This is making it very exciting.
Drop 700 convicted felons on an island. Some would be driven to create order out of chaos, and others would embrace chaos and say, let anarchy reign.
For men to play at war, play at it, play active, they're investigating it. And it is a healthy, legitimate thing to do, and I think it's a wonderful thing about acting and making films.